stuff. All right, let me start recording because I always forget to do that. And hello, welcome officially to the beginning of the third, I believe, installment of the... still talking with Nathan. Okay. This is the third installment of Star Wars Republic Commando Oral History. I was the lead programmer on that game. We're going to talk today with somebody who worked for me on the project, and I will get him on the line now, and then I'll do a little introduction. All right, let's get him on. You should probably hear the ringing there. There he is. Hey, Nathan, you there?
Yeah, how's it going, man?
Good. Here, let me give you your proper intro, as I like to do. Nathan Martz started off at LucasArts way back in probably, I want to say, 2002 or so. His first couple of titles were Bounty Hunter and some contributions to Red Rock, RTX Red Rock. And I believe you came in as an art intern, Nathan. Am I right about that, or were you?
No, I was never an intern. I was an art technical director at RTD.
Okay. Okay, yeah, that's right.
Actually,
yeah?
Yeah, I don't think I ever interned. I don't really remember.
It was a long time ago. From there, of course, he moved on and became the enemy AI and many other facets of gameplay programmer, of course, on Republic Commando. But his career did not stop there, although that was the end for so many of us at LucasArts. He moved on to Double Fine to help them with the last bit of Psychonauts, which I imagine was stressful, as I recall. And then, of course, on Brutal Legend, before ultimately becoming their studio technical director, and helping out on basically all of their projects, and, you know, coordinating the technical team. Probably my favorite of his is the Sesame Street Once Upon a Monster game, for which I bought an Xbox 360 Kinect and the game for some young nieces and nephews of mine. And they still play it today, so kudos there, Nathan. yeah, isn't that great? And nowadays he's working on some tech of his own, as well as working at Google. He's been working on some tech that's in Unity and is being used. I think its first game is with Firewatch, this tech called Sector. But
yeah, that's not Google. That's something I built.
Yes, no, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry. That wasn't clear. This was with Make Code Now, which is his own little company, and he sells this, I guess, through the Unity store. But you have since moved on from sort of games day to day, and are working at Google in search, right?
Yep.
All right, man. Well, thank you. Thanks for coming by.
Yeah, my pleasure to be here. It's always fun to talk about Republic Commando.
It is indeed. I love this game. I'm not gonna start where I left off last time, because I thought we would go back and talk about a couple of things that we've talked about by email with respect to. Oh, they're saying you're a little quiet, so if you could speak up there, Nathan, that'd be great.
Okay, yeah, sure.
Anyway, I thought I'd take us back to an earlier point in the stream so we could talk about some of the stuff with regards to the Geonosians and the sniping stuff that happened in here. I think this room's really good at showing the sort of jumping stuff, you know, jumping from point to point that we talked about. As I said, Nathan was the enemy AI programmer, so all this stuff is him. These stupid bugs. All right. So as you see these...
They're really smart bugs, Brett. They're really smart.
They're real... Yes, the bugs are smart, but not the ones in the eggs. I hate those. I think this really shows off well... not too many spawned here. But the jumping around, you know, from point to point, you know, they jump and land on places and things like that. You want to talk a little bit about, you know, how that was accomplished? Because that was a non-trivial thing, certainly back then.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I think there was, like, two pieces. One was, in the core design, you know, Tim Longo and I, like, this. Yeah, there he goes, just hung on a wall. You know, Tim Longo and I designed the AIs around these archetypes. I think you've talked about that, where we wanted AI to have, you know, to be all different from one another, not just, you know, the same soldier with different hats, but where every enemy would have different abilities. And so, you know, the Geonosians from the movie, they're these kind of, you know, melee guys, and it's really hard to make melee characters interesting in an FPS, because in most games, all that they can do is run up to you, and then you shoot them, you know, well before they get to you. It's like the scene from Indiana Jones, right?
Right, exactly.
And so the question was, like, well, how can we make these guys interesting? You know, keep the melee, but make them interesting in the context of an FPS. And so we decided to really focus on their agility and, you know, their bugs, so they can kind of, you know, fly and take long jumps. And the long jumps in particular wound up being a really interesting thing to play with. But the challenge is that, you know, it's easy enough for the AI to figure out that it wants to jump away. You know, pretty much there's a few different criteria, like, oh, have I taken too much damage? You know, do I not have a target? Do I just feel like it? But once they decide to jump, the hard part is figuring out actually where they should jump to. excuse me. There's, you know, there's like one guy. There's an entire level, and we're running this on an original Xbox. So they need to figure out, you know, where they can jump and if they can get there with very, very little CPU time. So the way that we accomplished it was every level has basically pre-authored attachment points that the level designers choose where they think sort of interesting attachment points would be. They pre-place those in the level, and then the AI, when it decides that it wants to jump, it finds a few points that are very close to it, and then it picks the one that it thinks is best, like right there, like, which usually means the not just the closest, but the one that it can get to. And there's actually another thing that's interesting, is that because these guys are jumping, they're actually moving in an arc, they're not moving in a straight line. And so, and in fact, when you think about, you know, if you think about two points, point A and point B, there's actually, you know, there's an infinite number of arcs that connect point A and point B. You know, some are really shallow, some are really are tall, but they're all different ways of getting to the same point. And so one of the things we had to figure out was, okay, once the AI has decided that he wants to jump, and once he's decided that he wants to jump somewhere, how do you actually compute a reasonably good arc for him to follow? And that's especially hard because the Geonosians live in these caverns, and so in a lot of cases there's a ceiling, and so, or there's pillars in the way, or there's a rock outcroppings, and so they actually have to pick a jump trajectory that is going to not just hit the point, but steer clear of any obstacles that would be in the way. And again, that all has to work on like an Xbox original CPU. So actually, we found a great article from a Game Jam's book, which is about this iterative trajectory computation where you can plug in two points and a start velocity, and then it will either sort of optimize the angle or optimize the velocity, and eventually it will pick what it thinks is a target trajectory. So we usually did a small number of iterations in that solver. And then we still had to check for collision geometry, because you don't want the AI to jump and then thud into something and look stupid.
Right.
The problem is, like, doing ray casts like for an arc would have been way too expensive. So we just did a ray cast from like their base position to the top of the arc, and from the top of the arc to their final destination. And usually that was very cheap, and it was usually sufficient to, if there was any big obstacles, that would catch it. And they would, you know, be pretty likely to make it to their destination.
Yeah, you do occasionally see them, you know, sort of bump into walls, but it is comparatively rare, especially, considering the power we had to deal with and sort of the limitations of that physics engine, which was fine, but sort of a first generation physics engine. It's really very impressive how much it's able to do that and keep the paths clear.
Yeah, there's a bunch of other cheats, like, you know, even when they actually, when everything goes well and they hit their point, they actually never hit it precisely. So there's a bunch of logic to kind of like, well, he's close enough.
Yeah, we can just kind of, you know, morph him into position, you know, lerp him there or whatever.
Yeah, we like turn off the real physics and play a little animation that hides the transition as we kind of like, we basically like suck them again. You know, they get close to the wall and then they get sort of sucked into the final position.
Right, right. Yeah, I mean, and one of the other things that I thought was particularly good, and I think the Geonosians are an excellent example of it, was the degree to which, you know, this was really a partnership between multiple disciplines.
Yeah.
You know, it was you working together with animators to get sort of like the launch, and then having a good sort of looping flying through the air thing, and then a land, or, you know, more than one land, depending on where they were landing, whether it was the wall or whatever.
Yeah.
And then beyond that, you also had, you know, LDs who were placing places in the world that would be good to jump to, you know, not just kind of expecting, us to kind of do all the work and figure that out, you know, not have it, which we really didn't have the CPU for. They actually would go and place good spots for things to jump to and things like that, and things that would work. The reason why I played through to this point is this was kind of a, I guess, the first time we see these elites, which I thought was another really good thing about how we did the enemies, was that we kind of gave them all good introductions. Mm-hmm. You know, good ways to kind of introduce them. This is, I think, the first time you see the elite that you can fight it, and it kind of jumps into view and does its big, you know, opening animation. It's what do we call those?
It's a space design for it. They're like intro vignettes, I think.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, they're great because it really kind of gets you a sense of the character, you know, the enemy character. It gives you kind of an idea of what you're up against in a very kind of brief amount of time. It's really, really nice that way. And I thought I would actually jump from there. And we only have a ton.
I just wanted to add one more point on the Geonosians, on the Geonosians in general, the elites and the regular warriors. That there's, you know, when people think about game AI, I think they think a lot about that the AI is smart itself. You know, that's kind of what you do when you're writing AI, is you build a really big brain for the sort of virtual agents. But in a lot of cases, the best thing you can do is put the smarts in the world. And that's, you know, like the jump points are a good example of that. That, like, the AI doesn't analyze the world and figure out where to jump. The world basically says, hey, I'm a really good place to jump to. Maybe you want to jump to me right now.
Yeah, exactly.
John used that pattern a lot with squad AI. You know, where, like, the breadcrumbs that you've talked about before. I think it's a really, you know, a really, like, really all of game AI is lots and lots of clever tricks. And I think that sort of, like, make the world as smart as the characters, or help build a world that helps the characters be smart, is one of the best sort of cheats out there.
Absolutely. And I think we, to a degree, that sort of philosophy came about partly from, like, The Sims was, like, the first really good example of that. I mean, it's literally built around the idea that, you know, all the objects would tell you how to use them and stuff like that, you know, and where they needed to be used and all that jazz.
The sort of finishing moves, which hopefully we'll look at later, you know, are actually worked in that Sims sort of fashion. You know, when you go to kill someone, they actually tell you how they would like to be killed. You don't decide how you would like to be killed in Republic Commando.
Yeah. I'm going to go now, and the other intro that you had specifically talked about was, let's see, I believe it's here, was the introduction of the scavs, which you particularly liked, and we can talk a little bit about their sort of overall, but I think this is where they first appear, right? Yeah, it should be right here. There's some Minox, and then there's this dude. And before this point in the game, you've sort of just heard, oh, I've been seeing static on my HUD, and then, you know, one of the commandos goes down, and then you see this guy. Yeah, we sort of tease these things a little bit at a time, and it's another smoke and mirrors kind of thing, where we kind of make them seem very threatening just by storytelling, you know, just like, you know, oh, I don't know what's going on, and there's this mystery, and I'm creeping through these dark tunnels. There's even, we'll see in here, I think, there's even things on the wall in here, oops, that's the wrong one, that, that poor guy, there's even these things on the wall, which are like, you know, a little bit maybe over-designed, like in terms of polygon and stuff like that. You look at it and you're like, oh my god, there's so much, you know, detail on these objects. But I think it's kind of to sell the idea that when you see other things on the wall, they would be just as detailed. And that kind of happens in a moment, which I love. A lot of good storytelling stuff having to do with the, you know, that sort of thing. And this whole section is really filled with that kind of stuff. Where
this is the most suspenseful part of the game, right? So it's you really, suspense requires a lot of that slow build, environmental storytelling, etc., etc.
Yeah, and we don't, I mean, we don't kind of overdo it. Like, it's not an hour, you know, it's a bit of, like, I mean, you've seen me play through it in, like, 3 or 4 minutes, but I started a little bit in from the very beginning. But it's basically just enough to kind of give you that sense. And you've got, like I said, you've got this, like, level of detail here, and then it's like, oh, what, you know, is this a thing? Oh, okay, that's a different thing. Phew, I don't have to worry about that one. I love this stuff.
I really had a lot of fun writing that suicide death. That was super cool.
Yeah, they're pretty fun. You know, it's funny, because there's not really a lot to them in that sense, but, you know, they're not a difficult enemy. They're sort of like those little bugs on the ground that I'm not crazy about. Mm-hmm. But they're tenacious, and you get a bunch of them on you, and it's suddenly a real threat. I mean, I'm playing in easy mode, so it's not so much, but...
Yeah, I think it's actually, there's an interesting contrast, because those little Geonosian bugs, like, I think that they're simple, like, they're not that much of a threat, and they're actually not that interesting, you know, they just sort of hop around and mostly go squish.
Yeah.
The scavs are, I think, a much more, you know, they're not a dramatically more complicated enemy, but they're much more interesting. You know, they've got a number, like, the suicide attack is cool, the fact that they can get on your faceplate is cool, their general, like, the fact that they fly is interesting, so it definitely is a good example of, like, what I thought was a very successful enemy design and a very not successful enemy design.
Yeah, that's fair enough. I mean, it just in terms of, like, they have kind of a small, you know, small amount of space that they occupy on the screen, so they are just threatening purely from a skills level, you know, and
right.
Especially in this part of the game, I'm going to actually load up into the next section of the game altogether, because that's where we get the brute. The thing I liked about this is that when you are alone and you don't have the squad to help you, you actually have to constantly be taking care of those scavs yourself. You know, and so the fact that they kind of occupy a fairly low amount of screen real estate and, you know, and it makes them very different from those bugs where I mostly just ignore them and let the squad take out the little bug things because, you know, they're an irritation more than they are a threat. These are really a threat. And
actually, in early versions of the scav AI, they were one of the most lethal enemies in the game because they could attack from behind you. Take that. and so, yeah, we actually had to, like, nerf them. There's actually, like, the scavs have a bunch of logic where if you're not looking at them, they turn off a bunch of different behaviors. So, like, they'll never do their kamikaze death if you're not looking at them. They'll never do their the grab your face if you're not looking at them. And actually, only a certain number of them will even shoot at you at a time. There's, like, a maximum. There's, like, a hotel. It's, like, a restaurant reservation system where they each get tickets and kind of wait in line, and if there's too many reservations, then they have to wait for, you know, a scav to die for the next one to get seated.
Yeah.
And that's all meant to keep them from being too difficult.
Yeah, otherwise they really are. And I definitely remember the times where they were overwhelming, you know, and it was really hard finding that balance of, you know, these things are cool and challenging versus these things will kill you more or less instantly, and it doesn't feel like fun anymore.
Yeah.
Because it's
another thing that people often, you know, miss with video game AI is that, like, building an AI that's incredibly hard is not difficult, right? Like, it's not at all difficult to give the AI perfect reflexes and infinite health and lots of damage, and all of a sudden they're really hard. It's like making them challenging is actually the real difficulty. You know, how do you make them feel like they're a threat and that you actually need to develop skills to be better than them, but not so difficult that they're just frustrating.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that I've said before in the stream is that we were developing a shooter for a Star Wars audience and not a Star Wars game for a shooter audience. And so we were trying to really manage that difficulty stuff a lot better than I think we had in previous Star Wars games. You know, often we had lots of wall missions, and although I do think there are parts of this game that are maybe still too difficult, or maybe due to random factors can be very difficult, I think by and large this was the most successful project I had in terms of managing that sort of thing, keeping in mind our audience a little bit better, and I think a lot of that comes down to choices like those of, like, you know what, some players would love that crazy level of difficulty, but not really our whole audience.
Yeah.
So you mentioned components a little bit. You want to talk about the sort of component behavior stuff?
Yeah, some of the folks are still saying it's a little quiet, I think. My audio, so you might want to I don't know if you can turn it up on Skype on your own.
I can. Let's see. Can I turn it up on Skype? That is a good question. I don't know how to. That would do that. What does this do? No, that does that. What does this do? Mute my microphone. I don't want that. I don't know how to. Let me see here. Call audio settings. That's probably what I want. Here we go. I turn that up, and I will not. How about that? Can you speak again?
Yeah, sure. If anyone's
that seems a little bit louder. A little bit louder to me, anyway. So it should be louder for them. I have turned the game down like as low as it can, but I don't have tons of different sorts of controls that I've hooked up for this. I just kind of like whatever I can grab off the shelf. Anyway, so we're about to go into talking about components.
Yeah, well, I think that was a really, the credit for that architecture goes to John Hancock, and the core problem is that we had something like a dozen different enemy AI types. We had the squad, and they had many different behaviors, and we needed to, we were pretty small, and it was really just two of us working on the AI for the entire game, and I was also doing a lot of other gameplay programming, like, level setups and things like that. So it was we had to figure out an architecture that would allow us to reuse as much as possible, where if we built a piece of behavior that was interesting, it had to be, we wanted to be able to use it on multiple different enemies. So what we actually did was the way the behavior system is written in Republic Commando is pretty much everything is a modular reusable chunk. There's the individual, we called states for the AI, which would be things like, run away, take cover, attack the player. Those were all designed to be modular. But then more interestingly, there were these actions that players could, or that the AI could do, that were the most kind of atomic building block. And so something like that death attack that you just saw, or firing a weapon, or charging the player to punch them in the face like this Trandoshan is trying to do, those were all modular pieces of code that pretty much any AI could do if we set up the config properly. So that's what, you'll see sometimes these Trandoshans will do a little hop to the side like that guy just did. Well, the Geonosians will also do that evasive hop to the side, and the Scabs will do that evasive hop to the side. And it's actually the same logic for all of them, but just configured a little bit differently and called at sort of different points in their high-level behavior. But we I think it was really a great example of we got a lot of reuse and efficiency by letting these guys mix and match things. And it became actually really critical at the end of the game where, originally we implemented finishing moves for the Wookiees. Because
right.
Wookiees are huge, and we wanted to make sure that they could look impressive when they killed something with their hands. But because we implemented it in a modular fashion, we realized, oh man, we can just, we don't have to do any new code, and now your squad mates can do finishing moves as well. All we need to do is do the animations, and it's going to work. And that kind of stuff was really, really powerful, and it allowed us to add a lot of life and variety to the game throughout development without a lot of additional code overhead. And the other thing that was really interesting was the state machine itself was designed to be flexible in terms of how it integrated with the level designers, because even though most of the time the AI is in control, there's a lot of cases where you actually, the level designers need to take control of a character or characters in order to, do a little bit of storytelling. And so we had to figure out a way that the AI could run and be doing its thing, but then a level designer could take over for a little bit and then hand control back to the AI. And so we had components that worked in our AI framework where they could essentially add a component. That component would say, I'm very important right now, and all the other components would shut themselves down while they waited for that scripted component to finish, and then they could seamlessly resume and keep doing whatever it was that they wanted to do.
Yeah, I mean, that I definitely remember. Oh, here's that monster closet room. I think among the most successful things that we did were things like that, where we wrote systems that enabled, and I should say you wrote systems, because I didn't write any of that code, but that the systems were written in such a way that they could do kind of the storytelling to really support the characters, like these You know, Trandoshans are these sneaky guys who jump out of closets, and you know that they're there to ambush you, and they're kind of maybe a little bit devolved, and they could do all these things just by kind of hooking up the data, you know, and not having to really bother you too much for, you know, individual bits of code beyond the sort of base AI.
Right. Actually, Brett, the folks are saying that the mics are still, the volume's not great. They actually said maybe turn your mic volume down.
Okay, let me try that. Sorry about that, gang. I am not super good at that stuff. All right, so this is, let's look at this mixer. Okay, applications, Skype. Skype is up all the way. System sound speaker, okay, let's see. Let me find my mic. Probably Commando, I might turn down just a little bit. Let's see. Oh, and I think in OBS I have a thing for that. I know I'm loud. I'm still loud. Okay, let's see. Settings. And audio. No. How about this? That's not actually the thing. Let's try this. No, that's not what I want. And let's try this. USB video audio configure. No. Okay, maybe it's just the gain on this thing. Might be up a little bit high. I'll try turning it down a bit. Let's try that. How's that? Lower. Also, I could just not talk as loud.
Yeah, now I almost can't hear you, Brett, so I'd turn it up a little bit.
Okay, turning it up a little bit more?
Sounds good to me.
Okay, good. All right, sorry about that, gang.
You guys, what's this for levels?
Okay. Brett, maybe you could lower my mic volume. Okay, yeah, I hear that. I can't hear myself, so, all right, I'm going back into the game here. Let's see. There we go. Where were we? So I remember especially the finishing moves being like that, where it was literally, you know, a dialogue that you had written in, you know, I don't know, into the editor.
Yeah.
I think I've gone the wrong way. Oh, there they are. You know, so that they could basically just hook that entirely up themselves to be like, oh, if you're behind a guy, you know, and you're within this distance, you know, and he's facing away from you, you know, rip his arms off and you break his back or whatever if you're a Wookiee. And I remember there being one animation, we're not to the Wookiees yet, but there was one animation that I think it was Bogan did right near the end that we didn't end up putting in because it was too close to ship and it maybe added memory. That was a real concern on the Xbox especially. And we had also already been ESRB rated, so I was a little worried because it was particularly vicious. Do you remember the head spike?
No, I don't remember that.
Oh, he did a really good and really violent. I remember you were like, oh, dude, we got to put it in. I'm like, oh, we just can't. I just can't risk. I can't risk it. We're not going to be here in a month, you know?
So you're apparently still loud, Brett. And actually, I think you talk more loudly.
When I'm playing.
With the controls.
All right, I'm turning down my gain again, so hopefully that will help. All right, I will try. It's because I can hear the game in my ears, and the game is very loud for me. I end up speaking up, but I will try to quieten myself.
All right, cool.
All right, so here I think right beyond this we're going to see the introduction of the Brute, which is another introduction. I think we called him the Brute, or maybe just the Heavy, Trandoshan Heavy.
The Heavy, I think is what we call him.
Yeah. It's a great example of the sort of character and the sort of archetype that you were talking about, you know, that he kind of mixes in with other characters. And you can hear him talking about it. And they're just, he just mows them down. I'm a little ahead of you. So he mows them down, he tucks one into the wall and shoots him up. And then we have to fight him. he is brutal.
Yeah, well, it's one of those things where it's just an interesting storytelling technique where, in a lot of cases, you know, we're basically, we don't want these guys to be much stronger than you or your squad mates. So we, the tool we use to show how powerful as they are is we have them, like, you know, fight, like, just decimate a bunch of regular clone troopers, and that establishes them as powerful. And it's actually a pretty good fiction technique, you know, even going back to, like, you read the Iliad, and it's the same thing, right? The heroes can't just kill each other, so how do you show how awesome the heroes are? Well, you make them take out a bunch of lesser guys.
Oh, I'm gonna get worked. Oh, I died! That always happens to me there. That guy is so tough!
Yep.
It's funny, I mean, it was a tough thing to balance a little bit, I can hear myself speaking louder already. It's a tough thing to balance to go to, you know, from the squad and having four guys, you know, and still paying off on a solo experience in those few cases that we do. Because, I mean, they are just the same enemies. We don't change their hit points. You know, none of that stuff is any different. So it's definitely a challenge that we had. All right. Because they have to be tough enough to be a challenge still. For the whole group. But do you want to talk a little bit more about the archetypes?
Yeah, well, I mean, we're definitely very inspired by Halo at this point. Before this, a lot of FPS. Well, I don't know. It's, you know, when you look at great FPSs, you know, early on, you have games like Doom. And Doom did really well with its archetypes, right? There's a lot of different kinds of enemies that you fight, and they're, you know, whether it's the Marine or the Imp or the the crazy Keiko demons, they all feel very different. But then, you know, around the time of, like, I don't know, Half-Life, like late 90s, early 2000s, a lot of people were really focused on kind of realistic shooters, and so there's this trend towards army men, you know, different kinds of army men, without a lot of, like, very gamey differentiation. And Halo had felt like a really, you know, a breath of fresh air when it came out, because it again went back to those kind of classic console gaming archetypes. And we were, again, very inspired by that. We wanted to get paid from it. But we wanted to do it in a way that felt authentic to the Star Wars source material. So that was really what, you know, Tim and I worked on, was, okay, given that we're doing the Star Wars game, or, you know, a shooter game for Star Wars fans, how can we take some of that archetypical DNA and work it into our product in a way that makes sense? And also, one of the challenges is that, like, when you do really different enemies, your cost goes up a lot. You know, it's much more expensive to make, you know, 12 characters that are completely different, from their, you know, skeletons to their models to their animation sets. It's much more expensive to do that than just take the same army man and, you know, put him in green pants or blue pants. And so that was, you know, a really intentional decision that Tim Longo and Chris Williams, the art director, and I made. We thought it would be worth it to spend the money on this variation, because it would make for a much more interesting game. And so then the job of, like, the game design was, okay, given that we're going to spend the money to create all these different characters, let's really make them as meaningfully different as possible. So there was, you know, Tim and I did a bunch of brainstorming sessions, and we tried to think about different ways that the enemies would be different in terms of how fast or how slowly they moved, in terms of, you know, whether they were, like, weak or tough, whether they were many or few, whether they were smart or stupid. And you can think of, you know, each of these kind of pairs of attributes, you can, you know, essentially, like, lay out on a, you know, on a whiteboard and be like, okay, there's a lot of them, and they're stupid, but they're weak, you know, and these other guys, there's just one of them, and he's stupid, but he's strong, and then this other one, there's a few of them, but they're smart. And you can basically look at that, you know, you can map all the enemies in the game to that sort of model. In fact, when I was writing the code, I had, you know, a printout of the design for every single enemy in the game, you know, like, nailed into the wall behind my desk, so that I was kind of surrounded by all of the different enemies. I was always thinking about the variety that we were trying to accomplish.
Yeah, I remember that. You had that sort of wall of enemies that were all kind of just laid out. And they're all, like, one-page designs. There's nothing. Oops. I do not need to be shooting my own guy. Who is shooting me? I've lost track here.
I think that might have been a scav.
No, it's, yeah, forget the droids. You're right, forget the droids. Let's move on.
I think another thing there is, as far as the go back to the components thing, all of the deaths were done in a component-wise fashion as well. You know, one of the real lessons for me, when I first started doing the AI for Republic Commando, I was thinking a lot about what it would take to make really smart AI. But we realized pretty quickly that I think the average life expectancy for an enemy in Republic Commando is like 10 seconds. You know, most enemies don't, they're spawned, you know, just before you go into whatever room they're in. And they only have, you know, seconds to tens of seconds to survive, right? Like, these guys were just created and now they're dead.
Yeah.
I guess I'm probably behind the stream a little bit.
No, that's fine.
So what we found is that actually, you know, what, even though you want enemies that are interesting when they're alive, you actually really, like, what's most important is that they die in interesting ways. Right, that the most important thing that any given enemy in an FPS does is die. and especially when there's a lot of them, you want to have a lot of variety. So that was, we needed a death system that could be really flexible. So again, we built this modular, data-driven, component-wise system where there were essentially a bunch of different kinds of deaths. So you could, there was the death where you go into a ragdoll. There's the death where you charge the player and explode. There's the death by finishing move. There's the death where, your upper body rips off the lower body and crawls at the player. All of those different things were sort of atomic behaviors. And then the designers could specify conditions when those behaviors would happen. And so they would say for some things like, well, for this enemy, if he was last hit in the head before he died, then do this sort of behavior. Otherwise, do a ragdoll. But for this other kind of enemy, if he was last hit by an explosion, do this sort of behavior. And so that the fact that we were, it was all this like modular data-driven system allowed the level designers to really configure very, very different behaviors for the enemies. It wasn't just the LDs, it was myself and the LDs. We're able to make these enemies that have, each of them have maybe like a dozen different death routines, all of which are, like, feel different, but use a lot of the same building blocks under the hood.
Yeah, that's pretty great, because I had done, sort of something similar for Starfighter, but it was really all pretty hand-coded by me. You could sort of put different behaviors on different different ships, I guess. Like, it wouldn't make sense for this type of ship to barrel roll and destroy or something like that. So there was sort of a data-driven component, but they didn't have sort of that fine-grained control that really made this kind of stand out. Of course, the ships were kind of even greater differences in size, so it's kind of a reason for that, I guess. But I love the turret behaviors. I love them just going to town.
Nice lighting in this level, incidentally. That's one of my favorite levels for lighting.
Do you remember who would have done these? I want to say Reed did a couple, Reed Knight, the sort of latter half of these, I think. And I don't know who else would have worked on these.
Yeah, I don't remember who the environment artist was.
This is really, really lovely. Lots of good just sort of static storytelling. Really terrific stuff. All right, we're gonna go into the next room. We gotta get our Delta back. So what lessons did you take on in moving forward? To the rest of your career? Do you think?
Brutal Legend actually was inspired by a lot of some of the systems of Brutal Legend were actually really inspired by Republic Commando. We, like, the AI, like the way we structured our state machines in Brutal Legend was very, very similar. It was what's called a utility-based state machine where you, the states vote and decide which one is going to be active rather than explicitly saying, and now go into this state. Excuse me. So that's pretty interesting. We like a pattern that's certainly carried forward. The data-driven design, we use that a lot in this where we try to have the code, described, it would be parameterized, so you could change the behavior based on changing the parameters, and that was certainly something I've carried through a lot of future projects. Trying to think of the other really, putting the smarts in the world, that's all over the place. In fact, you were mentioning the Sims, where, in the Sims, there's a sim, and then there's all of these different kinds of objects in the world, right? There's the coffee pot, and there's the refrigerator, and the TV, And the normally you would think that it would be the sim that knows how to use, like the AI would know how to use a coffee pot and know how to use a refrigerator and know how to use a TV. But the way that's implemented is actually when the sim decides to use the TV actually tells the sim what animations to play in order to use it. And we actually took that model, we used that here in Republic Commando, but we also used it in Brutal Legend for all of our co-ops. And in Brutal Legend, we had this like, there's three factions and there's something like 10 or 20 units per faction, and each of them needs to have a special move when you interact with them. And so that this sort of this pattern that we used in Republic Commando, borrowed from The Sims. Oh, there's a great finishing move, yeah.
That's a good one.
Seconds behind. And also an AI bug that you guys stuck against the wall. excuse me. Like, those were really, really powerful takeaways. And also with just in general, Unreal, this was an Unreal Engine game, and I think Unreal Engine, especially around this time, took a lot of flack for being, not very well architected, being kind of clunky and heavyweight. But the truth is that there was a lot of great patterns also in Unreal Engine. The editor was really powerful. The way that they made it easy to expose code properties into the editor is something that Unity uses now, and I've used a lot in future games.
Yeah, it was particularly good, and I know you made a lot of adjustments to it as well.
Well, and Scott Peter especially, he was the, thank goodness for that guy, because he'd shipped an Unreal game previously, so knew exactly what sorts of things to change.
Yeah, absolutely. He definitely knew what he was doing. I haven't talked much about Scott on the program. I'm not sure, is he still over in Germany? He went from here to Crytek, I think.
He works at Crytek now.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't talked to him in a long time, because I don't think he makes it stateside very often.
Just for conference. Like, he was at GDC this year. I ran into him there.
Oh, cool. I wish I had known. I would have loved to have seen him. Yeah, cool. Well, good. I hope he's doing well.
Yeah, as far as I know, he seems to be.
Yeah, awesome. He's so many hours. It's hard enough getting people in California onto the stream because of time zone changes.
Right.
I can't imagine. He must be like 8 hours ahead of us. I don't know. I'll have to think about that. See if I can do that.
Yeah. There's folks on the Twitch stream talking about the bump mapping had an issue with the PC version, which doesn't surprise me. The bump mapping in Republic Commando is this like super duper cheated kind of bump mapping that worked on basically Xbox-grade hardware, where you didn't even have proper shaders, or just you had sort of these very primitive versions of shaders.
Yeah, it was fixed function, right?
It wouldn't surprise me if there are issues, excuse me, where like modern hardware doesn't support those instructions very well anymore.
Yeah, no, I know that somebody's done a mod to get it working again. Oh, these guys are gonna die. I know that there's a mod that somebody has mentioned on the YouTube channel, I believe. I don't have the link handy, but I will try to remember to have that in the next stream for people who want to get that in. I haven't messed with it just because I'm afraid to mess anything up right before I go to stream. And this week in particular, I have been spent a lot of time on my back, so I've not wanted to do that. But I've been suffering
Corey Play asked a question I don't quite understand. So maybe Corey, can you rephrase your question?
I would like some explanations on why is that? Since some people say about if you could rephrase, Corey, that would be great. I'm glad you're looking at the. I'm glad you're looking at the chat, because I find I can't do all these different things. I think we'll do it this way this time. But whoops. I wanted to do that. Okay, there we go. Yeah, so we've talked a little bit about the componentized AI and the importance of the death. I do remember we also had to support so much with animation because the physics system, and this isn't true on the PC, but the physics system I don't think could handle more than one or two ragdolls on the Xbox.
Yeah. That's right, yeah, that was actually, yeah, I mean, this was, like, at the very, very beginning of, excuse me, of, like, when Ragdolls first hit the scene. And, you know, this we were using a physics engine called Math Engine, which I think eventually became what's now Aegea PhysX from NVIDIA, but through, like, three different acquisitions.
Right, because it was, yeah, it was like, Karma Physics for a while and stuff like that.
I don't even remember. Yeah, Karma, it became Math Engine, then Karma, and then I can't remember if it became part of PhysX or was bought, became part of Renderware. But at any rate, it doesn't exist anymore as an independent thing. But yeah, I mean, the Ragdolls were really, really expensive. Because each, you know, it had to simulate, you know, every, do the collision for every part of the guy's body. And it actually took us forever. I worked with the technical director, Jeremy Talbot. We basically spent, you know, the entire development constantly tuning and retuning the physics to make sure the ragdolls looked at least somewhat realistic. We get all these crazy bugs where, you know, if you hit the joint too high, the guy's arm would fly off, but it would still be attached. So you'd see these
straight, yeah,
arms stretching across the scene as the arm flopped around, or guys would get, like, wedged partway in level geometry. So it really was very flaky, very unstable. And even after we got it sorted, like you said, the performance was too high to have all of the enemies ragdoll all the time. And so there's a system where if it's out of ragdolls, it will fall back to an animation for certain kinds of deaths. And actually, that too we used on Brutal Legend, because even though Brutal Legend was an Xbox PS3 game, it was, you know, much like, we still had a finite amount of horsepower and had to limit those ragdolls.
Yeah, I remember there being a E3, our demo level that we did in the theater. Remember we had that theater that we had to we had a tester. We had two testers. Johnny, was it Johnny? I can't remember now. I don't remember who the two were, but they were able to manage the ragdoll count. And there was one place in particular where the Wookiee would, like, kill one guy, and he had to ragdoll. But if you did it at the same time, you know, if you shot somebody at the same time, it would just freeze in air. I don't know if you remember that. Yeah, and they had to, like, they basically would use the gun like I'm doing now. To cover up, you know, part of the scene to avoid that problem.
That's right, I remember that, yeah. So Corey, he just rephrased his question. Said, some people say that the Unreal Engine launched with this game, so this would be like, it's called Unreal 2.5X, didn't support bump mapping, so we had to do our own implementation. And I don't remember, honestly, the specifics. I do believe that version of the engine did have bump mapping, but I think it also required, like, it was very expensive, the version that it came with. Like, you had, I think it was, the bump mapping was computed per light, and so on the Xbox you could essentially only have one light on the character if you wanted bump mapping. But for our game, we needed actually, like, it's so environmental, when we had just one light, it looked really bad, the characters didn't fit in the environment. And so, if I recall correctly, Tim Ramsey, the graphics programmer, actually implemented a kind of, like, image-based rendering, where at least for the clone troopers and other, like, hero characters, they basically bake all of the lights that are near them into a cube map, or I think it was a sphere map at the time, and then they use that as the single light source to combine with the bump mapping. And it also uses a cheap, kind of tricky form of bump mapping. I think this school is called EMBM, environmental bump mapping, which is based more on, like, fudging texture coordinates around than on actually doing the, like, proper normal math light math. So I think that's why we, at least in Republic Commando, it was to get the lighting and the bump mapping working properly. That's what required the custom coding.
Yeah, that sounds right to me. It was definitely Tim doing the work, and that merging the lights sounds very familiar now that you're kind of talking about it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, and it was crazy because, you know, we couldn't afford to update. This basically every character had essentially a light probe that they carried with them, but we couldn't afford to update them, all of them, every frame. And so there's a sort of round robin scheme where every frame one person would get to update their lighting, and in some cases, you know, some characters would be higher priority so they could jump the line. But in general, you know, everybody would update, you know, they'd get one frame to update and then they'd have to wait for it to be their turn again. And so theoretically it could have caused, like, popping and artifacts, but it actually looked really good. And you can see as the you know, clones, especially your squad, moves around through the environment, they look perfectly well lit, even though there's a bunch of cheats going on to make it possible on the original Xbox.
Oh, there he is.
There's a guy, I'm Scorch, asks, what got you into programming? Scorch, are you asking me or Brett?
Well, you go ahead, Nathan. I can do it afterwards.
Yeah, well, I mean, I would say that for me it was a bunch of different things. I actually started college as an English major. I wanted to be a novelist. But, you know, for a variety of reasons, realized that I was better suited to computery things, which had been my interest for most of my childhood. And so I switched to computer graphics and started out on the art and animation side. And then as I was in there, I got more and more into programming. And I started programming using writing Mac script and writing Maya, Mel and Maya. Basically, because I was building art, I realized that I needed better tools to help me build the art and help my friends build art. So I just started, I got into it from kind of a tools perspective. And then I took CS classes while I was in university. Like Brett said, I actually started out at LucasArts building tools for artists as an art technical director. But at the very end of Bounty Hunter, we had this crazy... Bounty Hunter was my very first game professionally, and it was a really important game to LucasArts. But we had this major issue where, because of the way the game was built, we were almost done with the game. In terms of, we were almost at the deadline for the game, but much of the AI wasn't implemented. And so we had this like all hands on deck scramble where it was like, anybody who can and wants to write some basic enemy AI, please go do that, because we were desperate to ship the game in time for the DVD release of episode 2. So I most of my art tools were done at that point, so I volunteered to help out with the with some of this AI, with actually doing programming in the game, and I found it really satisfying that being able to do programming that was that people actually interacted with, rather than just that our developers used to help make the game, was awesome. And for me, there was no going back at that point. Gotten that taste of implementing player facing code rather than developer facing code, that was why I did the Enemy AI and Public Commando and all the stuff I did on Brutal Legend and on Once Upon a Monster.
Yeah, for me, I actually started, and we're only going to probably go another 5 minutes because I'm going to need to go lie down, but I actually started quite a bit earlier. I started programming when I was, I think, 9, possibly 10, because we had Apple IIs at my school, and that was really most of what you could do with them. I mean, I was very lucky to be in sort of an experimental class at my elementary school, which was kind of interested in pushing students, young students, further than they normally demanded of students. Just students that they thought could hack kind of higher standards were kind of pushed into these different sorts of classes that allowed that. So I had a very good science class, and I had a very good English class, very challenging English class, as I recall. I also, in college, though, thought I was going to be an English major, then I was a physics major, and that's what I ended up being, a physics and philosophy major. Towards the end of that, I decided to go back to computer science, which was something I had loved as a kid, programming the Apple II was just great. And so I kind of was like, oh, I wonder what happened, with games. Turns out games, while I was in college, had gone from, kind of a small garage thing to a enormous industry. I think the year that I joined the industry, EA had $1 billion year or something like that. So it had become quite a big deal in the intervening time. Earlier on, Nathan, you mentioned the sort of voting utility AI. I just recalled that for people who are interested, that is actually, I think Hancock wrote a chapter about that in one of the Game Programming Gems books.
I think it was actually AI Game Wisdom.
That's right, AI Game Wisdom.
Or something like that.
Yep. So for people who are interested in that, beyond the kind of cursory talk about it we've given, totally worth reading.
Yeah, it's a really powerful pattern and gets around a lot of the problems with the classic finite state machines. And actually now, there's a lot of new hotness, like behavior trees and things like that. But definitely worth the read if you want a sense of a simple, really useful pattern for AI.
Yeah, and he had actually employed that, I think, prior to this on Obi-Wan.
That's what I think he did first.
Yeah, and which
so,
is...
Pyrolite Dota says, have you guys heard anything about a sequel after your finished game and it ended in this cliffhanger? So, I mean, basically, in some respects, we were really fortunate that Republic Commando got finished. You know, their LucasArts has had a habit of changing presidents, you know, every 2 to 3 years. And whenever they did that, there was inevitably a bunch of things got canceled or shuffled around. And in our case, you know, we got a new president about halfway into Republic Commando. And the president then, Jem Ward, was basically said, you know, I don't get this Republic Commando game. It really just didn't make sense to him that it's, you know, it's a shooter, it's Star Wars, why aren't there Jedi? He said, but fortunately, he said, even though I really don't get it, you know, I get that it's good. I think let's finish it. And so, you know, like he supported it enough to get out the door with the modest marketing budget. But I don't think it was, you know, he really had this vision of Star Wars games like The Force Unleashed, of these sort of giant tentpole events that would be every few years, you know, the biggest thing out. And Republic Commando, you know, a game that was in Star Wars, but intentionally not Star Wars-y, or not a classic, you know, Jedi-centric Star Wars, didn't fit into that model. So I think that, you know, before LucasArts shut down, there was some, some people who were trying to get a sequel greenlit. But then since the Disney acquisition, of course, there is no LucasArts and et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, there were originally two competing ideas. One was based around Order 66, I guess, which is third movie stuff. And I, as I've said before on the stream, I haven't seen the prequels, so other than the first one. So I don't really know too much about that. And the other one was one where Sev would go on to found the Rebellion. He would be the first soldier in the Rebellion and take his sort of tactical knowledge to that. It would sort of be the reason behind there being, you know, these sorts of tactical maneuvers and taking this model of interaction with the squad forward. So those were the two competing ones. I was more in favor of the latter. I think you were too, Nathan, because the other one involved Jedi, which were, you know, making good challenging melee opponents at that time would have been, and still it's a challenge.
Hard. I mean, there's, you know, still very few FPS games that are primarily melee from the player's perspective that are good.
Yeah, it's very hard to do.
Yeah. So, Elks Shipper asks a question for both of you. If it sounds like you had a lot of ownership over the design of the game as programmers, how did the team decide on decisions like the enemy types? And just a quick recap, I would say that. Really, Tim Longo, the design director for this game, one of his gifts was designing by, like, empowering his team and building consensus. And so, you know, Tim had final say on, or really Darren, you know, had final say on if the teams couldn't come to a decision, you know, Darren or Tim would make the final call. But in general, the game was really collaborative, and you know, Tim encouraged people to own pieces of the game rather than just building what he thought they should make. And in fact, as I recall, the credits for Republic Commando, it says designed by the Republic Commando team. So there's, you know, really, like that was very much the spirit of development was what the credits said.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was true. This was my third game with Tim. That was definitely true of his two prior games that I had done with him, Starfighter and Jedi Starfighter. He was all about consensus, and I believe both of those games also say designed by the team, and that's still the way I believe he works today. Though I don't work with him anymore. He is currently working on, I guess, the Halo franchise, which is pretty cool. He is enjoying himself up there in the Seattle area. Man,
some people are talking about how co-op would be amazing, and that's maybe, like, you know, co-op was something we talked about a lot during development, right?
Yeah, I should cop to that now, because I'm also to blame for that. it was something I was going to talk about when we got to multiplayer, which I hope we're going to get a chance to do in a couple of weeks. But yeah, I was speaking on behalf of our multiplayer team, but I am the reason why there is no co-op in Republic Commando. I had to make
reality is the primary reason.
I know. Everybody still wanted it. There is supposedly, I remember there being a bug opened by QA, that is, it's possible to set up co-op, and they marked it as a 3B, like not important to fix bug, and we closed it immediately. I think what you need to do, for anybody who's interested, you can start up the game, start up a server for multiplayer, and load one of the single player levels. And if you then invite somebody in, I think they join in and you can just play the game co-op. It's not...
There's tons of stuff that must break if you do that.
I'm sure there is. Like, it's not a designed game around that, and that was actually part of the real problem was that...
I think there's a lot of, none of the AI works client-server, so there's probably lots of crazy jank and desyncs in that.
Yeah, I mean, I think probably the squad... Well, if you load in multiplayer, you may not even get the squad. I'm not sure how it worked, but they were like, "Well, it can be done," and we're like, "Okay, well, knock yourself out if that's what you want to do." but there was a way to do it. Yeah, I know, it's entirely janky. I'm sure it's not great, but it does, I think, update where characters are and things like that properly.
I guess the thing, for the folks listening on the stream, I would say is that, like, you know, it's really as fans, we often like, "Oh man, why didn't they add co-op? You know, it seems so obvious." But, you know, as developers, you're always, you know, wrestling with practical realities, right? You only have, you know, so many people and so much time, so much energy and inspiration, and you can't do everything. And, you know, in this case, you know, we certainly weren't going to be able to get more budget for something like co-op. And, it would have required basically a significant engineering re-implementation and significant design changes. And the intersection of those was just too much for the team to handle. And especially, you know, this version of the Unreal Engine, the way multiplayer was implemented was if you built something for like a given system, like an enemy AI, building it for single player wasn't that hard. But if you want to build it for multiplayer, you basically doubled or tripled the amount of work it would take to write that feature because you had to do all this like client stuff and server stuff and client server stuff. So it just was, it was very possible, but it would have been a tremendous amount of additional code and debugging, which there just wasn't time for.
Yeah, I honestly, as difficult as the technical issues would have been, I think the biggest challenges were really in design, and I think that the team wasn't really prepared or understanding of that. All right, I think I'm gonna save here, because the I can't save here, because the things like, oh, well, if you go through a door and it's supposed to lock behind you and things like that are major issue.
You're right.
You know, and in Halo, they just didn't care too much about that. They just kind of forwarded. They would pick a player to be the lead character, and if the other player lagged behind, they just kind of warped him. But that would have been really against our kind of ethos of the game and sort of, you know, making it as realistic as I think we did. Well, Nathan, I really appreciate you coming on, man. It was awesome to catch up with you on the game. Sorry about the audio issues. I'll have to look into that next time. It's hard to kind of fix that stuff on the fly. And I'm not even sure which microphone it's pulling from at this point, so I'm just going to have to fiddle with that. But thanks so much. Thanks for watching the chat and picking up on people's questions. It was great to chat with you, buddy.
Yeah, great to chat. Have a good day, and thanks to everyone who watched the stream live.
Okay. All right, take care now. Right. I'm going to hang up on you. Bye. All right, well, thanks, everyone, for joining. That was Nathan Martz again. I just wanted to make sure I repeated his name. He had his start at LucasArts. He worked for me there on this game and then moved on to Double Fine and has since left games. At least that's his full-time job to work at Google. He was a guy who really helped make this project, and it was really terrific to see him grow and develop as a developer over that time. He grew a ton, and it was really, really wonderful to see. Okay, I'm going to stop streaming and recording now. Thanks for all coming by, and I will see you next time. Cheers.